Everybody to AP Calculus AB. Today we've got section 1.3, continuity. Now, this is a big thing. It's going to be a very short lesson, but it's a very foundational concept. So we're going to start learning some theorems in calculus that are going to help us justify some further work that we need to do. So recognizing when a function is continuous over a certain interval is going to be a huge backbone for allowing us to do other things. So although this lesson may seem pretty quick and relatively intuitive, this will be something that we really want to be sure that we understand how to use it. And so we'll see that connect with some other things later on. So just realize this is a very, very important kind of cornerstone for calculus kind of lesson. All right, so what does continuity mean? Well, a function is continuous at an interior point of its domain, meaning we're in the middle someplace of its domain, if the limit as we approach some value of c for our x value, that actually equals the height there. In other words, if we have a nice function and we pick some point in the middle of its domain, as I approach that point from the left and from the right, both sides agree on that height. It actually equals the height there. So as long as I can do that with any point and left and right agreement is happening everywhere, we have what's called a continuous function. So a good word for continuous is, if we're thinking of it graphically, everything's all connected up. So like as we approach a point on the graph, it's connected to the next point. And that's what gives that limit definition. That's what kind of an illustrative way of seeing that it's working. Now, say we're working on a closed interval, or we have a domain like a square root function that has an endpoint on it. We can determine continuity at an endpoint if we just look at what's happening as we get close. So let's say we're looking at the left endpoint. So we're saying as x approaches that left endpoint A from the right, does that actually equal the height there? There's no left-hand side to agree with it, so we just want to make sure that as I choose points closer and closer, they're agreeing with the same height as that endpoint. Similarly, on the right, we look at the right endpoint where x is equal to b over here. Does the limit of the function as I approach that last x value of b, does that actually equal, or is it leading me towards the height of the function at that point? All right, so it's basically just kind of looking at a limit, one-sided limit versus a two-sided limit, just what's happening as we get close. Is it what we want it to be? All right. Now, as the lesson sort of implies, continuity in recognizing whether a function is continuous or not is kind of a big deal, and there are places where functions are not, and those are called discontinuities. And there are four main categories. The first is called a removable discontinuity. So that means that we're still able to evaluate the limits. So a really good example, I mentioned this here, is like a rational function that has a hole in it. And so we're able to essentially pretend that discontinuity doesn't exist. So let's imagine we have a graph that's otherwise nice and smooth and connected, and there's a hole in it, and maybe it jumps for a point. We've seen some graphs like that. So this is a removable discontinuity because at every single interior point except for this one, we have that nice left and right agreement as we look at every single point along the way. It's all smooth and connected, but that one little point, if we remove that, then there's no issues. All right, that single solitary point. All right, and so we're going to look at how we can kind of patch these types of holes in functions to make them continuous. So we've also already done this work algebraically. The next type is called a jump discontinuity. We've also seen functions that exhibit this. So a good example is that greatest integer function that kind of stair-steps its way up. I believe we saw that in an earlier section. But every time we reach one of these places in the graph where as we come in from the left and we come in from the right, we jump in the graph, so they're not connected at all, that's a good example of a discontinuity. An infinite discontinuity, when the one side limit from the left and the right approach vertical asymptotes when reaching a desired x value. So this is a discontinuity because the graph is not connected here. Sorry, I should have done this in black, so it's kind of color-coded with my graphs up there. But if we have a graph, let's say have a vertical asymptote, and we'll see pictures of these down below too as well, but as I approach this desired x value in the graph, they both race up towards infinity. And yes, they do agree on a height, so the limit does exist at that x value. It is an infinite, but However, the graph is still not connected, so this is a discontinuity, even if the sides agree. And the last type, probably unlikely that you're going to encounter this one just from a College Board concept, but we do have graphs that oscillate, like sine and cosine. I guess I'll nestle that one in here. But where they're oscillating, and then when you get to a certain region, they start oscillating really fast, and then faster and faster and faster and faster, and then they start opening up again. So that's what the sine of 1 over x looks like. And so when we get into the middle here, as we approach it, even if we zoom in on our calculator, you'll just notice that you get this, like, it's almost like a filled-in rectangle. It is impossible to tell where that point is going to be. So this is a discontinuity just because it's so cluttered in there. We can't tell what the graph is doing height-wise. We can't see it be all nice and connected and smooth. All right, so here's our first of two very, very big, and I'm just going to put, like, I don't know, six stars around this, very, very big theorems. So this is called the Intermediate Value Theorem, or the IVT, and College Board will accept that abbreviation. A function that is continuous on a closed interval, so that's like the hypothesis, it takes on every value between that output at the initial x value and the output at the final x value. So it guarantees existence. So you might want to put a little blank here that says for existence. In other words, you may see an FRQ question that says, could there exist a value, blah, blah, blah. And this would be a theorem that would say, yes, there exists by this theorem. So this is how we will end up using this in the long run, but let's break down how it works right now. So let's say that we are on our curve over here that we have graphed for us. And we're looking at this curve on the interval between x equaling a and x equaling b, and that's a closed interval. So that means that this curve on the interval we're looking at, it has a left endpoint at a and a right endpoint at b. And each of those points has a certain height. Here's f of b, here's f of a. And so the theorem says that as long as we know this is a continuous function, we know that a and b have to be connected. So our curve could pass through them in this way. I'm going to go ahead and take that line out. Here it's connected the other way. We know that every output that connects the output at a with the output at b, everything else has to be reached that's in between there. Now the graph may go beyond that. So here you can see our graph drops a little bit below or a little bit above, and that's allowed, but we know without a shadow of a doubt, because we have a continuous function, we are going to get every single one of these outputs in between. So if f of x is continuous on, I'm just going to rewrite this, I think it looks better this way, on some interval of x's between a and b, then f of x will output every I guess we could say, or maybe f of b gives us the lower output. All right, so if we're between those two x values on this closed interval, we know we're continuous, we're going to be between the lower and higher output values no matter what. So that's kind of nice. What it makes me think of is, if you've ever gone fishing where you're like wading through the water, sometimes you'll be out in the water and you'll see like a sandbar or something that's up high on the other side, and you're in the water a certain amount. As you're walking towards that sandbar, you may go down in the water, you may go, you know, up above, maybe you step over a large rock or something, but you know that your feet are going to go from where you're at right now in the water, they are going to reach every single height up until you get to that sandbar. You may step a little bit lower, you may step a little bit higher, but you know you're going to go from where you're at now to where you see, you know, your target location. That's just a visual that I get when I think of that. All right, let's get into some examples. So First of all, find the points of discontinuity, or sorry, points of continuity and the points of discontinuity of this function, and identify any of the places where we have a discontinuity. So number two, we have a rational function. So the first thing we want to do is look for any holes in the graph. And so that means we are going to factor out that denominator. My numerator is a linear factor of x plus 1. And in the denominator, it looks like this. I'm going to check and see if that's a typographical error, because right now it looks like we don't have any holes in the graph. I just want to double check. If that were a minus 1 in the numerator and I mistyped it, that could make a difference. So I'm just going to do a little fact checking right now. So we're on section 1.3. That is number 2. Nope, we copied it correctly. Minus 4x plus 3. Yep. Okay. So in my denominator, I still want to factor it out. So this isn't a wasted effort. Is x minus 3 x minus 1? All right, and I'm hoping by the time we reach AP calculus, we can look at a trinomial like that and pretty quickly factor it out. That's an algebraic skill that's emphasized very heavily in Algebra 1 and Algebra 2. So hopefully we've polished that up pretty nicely. So we notice that there are no holes in the graph, which are contenders for removable discontinuities. So thankfully, we don't have to worry about that one. But we do know there are also two vertical asymptotes that happen when x equals 3 or x equals 1, as those will zero out the denominator. All right, now holes and asymptotes are the only types of discontinuity that we can expect from a rational function like this. It's not going to jump, and it's not going to do any type of oscillating behavior. That's kind of reserved for sines and cosines. So these two x values are points of discontinuity. Those are both infinite discontinuities. That means that this function is continuous on the set of x values such that x does not equal 3 or 1. As long as we're not on one of those asymptotes, we're nice and connected. Problem number 8. Here we've got a cotangent of x. Okay, and again, this is a cotangent function, so there are no holes in the graph or anything like that. It's trigonometric, so we're not going to get any like factoring or canceling to happen there. And if I imagine what a cotangent graph looks like, again, big point of emphasis from our trigonometry work, you know that cotangent starts at an asymptote. And then at pi over 4, pi over 2, and pi, once it gets to, sorry, this should be 3 pi over 4. And then at pi radians, that's where we get to our next asymptote. And it wiggles down like this. So really, we have 0 and we've got pi that are vertical asymptotes. And that's going to repeat on and on and on and on. So we're going to say that this has infinite discontinuities. At all x such that x equals 0 plus, I guess we could just say n pi. So as long as x equals some multiple of pi, we have a vertical asymptote there. And those are infinite discontinuities. It's continuous. Oh, that's terrible handwriting. Continuous. On the set of all x values such that x does not equal a multiple of pi. All right. Next, use the function that's defined here as a piecewise, and it's already been graphed for us to answer the following questions. Now, we're going to be able to use the graph to handle just about all of this. So first of all, letter A, does f of 1 exist? Notice this is not a limit. It's not asking me if it's all connected or anything there. If I plug in a 1 into this function, sure enough, there's a place for an output there. It's the point 1, 1. So yes, f of 1 equals 1. If I put an x value of 1 in, I'm going to get a y value of 1 out. Does the limit as x approaches 1 exist? So now, not actually at that value, but as I get close from the left and the right, sure enough, they agree on a height. Yes. That limit exists. the limit as x approaches 1 of f of x equals 2. Does the limit as x approaches 1 actually equal the value there? No. 1 does not equal 2. So is f continuous at 1? No. And then in parentheses, I'd probably say this is a removable discontinuity. I'm struggling with the handwriting today. Continuity. At what values of x is f of, or is the function f continuous? Well, take a look. If we go from left to right, we start off at an x value of negative 1. There is an endpoint there. And notice as I approach that endpoint, the heights are falling in line just with what we'd expect coming in from the right-hand side. So the limit does, the function is continuous at that left endpoint. So we are continuous. I'm going to use interval notation here because there's a lot of pieces. So from negative 1 up until we get to an x value of 0, and we're not going to include that. Because if I take a look at the right, I'm approaching there, the function actually doesn't even exist when x equals 0. And so we can't consider that part of describing where it's continuous. But that's where it faces a jump discontinuity. The graph jumps up here, and then from 0 up until we get to that value of 1, we're all continuous, right? Because as I look at all the points here from the left and from the right, everything agrees on where it should go. And so we're continuous all the way up until we hit that open circle there, what we evaluate in parts A and B. And then as soon as I get past that point and I go from 1 to 2, this is all continuous, a nice smooth connected graph. I keep saying smooth, but that's going to be a concept covered next chapter. We're focusing just on connectedness here. And sure enough, we come all the way down here, and then we find that the graph does not have a point at 2. So we can't include that in our description. We're set. And then lastly, from 2 to 3, this is a nice constant, you know, level segment of the graph. So that also is a place where the graph is continuous. However, notice that this right endpoint does not exist. So we cannot call that a point of continuity on this graph. All right, now here you can see one of the advantages of interval notation. This was a very clean way of writing this instead of that squiggly brace, all values of x such that x is here or here or here or here. The interval ends up being a lot more succinct, would be a good word. All right, next, problem 24. Find each point of discontinuity, which ones are removable or not removable. Okay. So our discontinuities, let's check. We got an endpoint here at negative 1, and it falls in line with the graph leading up to it, so we're good. Then it comes down here. It's got a weird little cusp in the graph, but again, everything's all connected up. The limit's just what I would expect from both sides, even at that sharp corner in the graph. And as we keep going this way, we're good until we get to this spot. There's a jump in the graph. That would be a discontinuity. As I come into that value from the left and from the right, we're not agreeing. So our first point of discontinuity is x equals 1. Next, as I move through the graph, everything's looking good. Oop, and then I get to x equals 2, where the graph suddenly jumps in height again. However, since this is a single point, it's a removable discontinuity. All right, and then as we move on the rest of the way, everything's good all the way up until that endpoint. So these were our only two points of discontinuity. So this is a jump. It is not removable. X equals 2, this is a removable discontinuity. All right. So if we were to explain why, the reason that this is not removable is because the limit as x approaches that x value of 1 of f of x, it just does not exist. However, at x equals 2, the limit as x approaches 2 of f of x does exist. It equals a height of 1, but the actual f value at 2 equals something else. So it's the difference between the limit existing there and just the limit not agreeing with the actual value. And that's a very good explanation. Use the limits to explain. They save you a whole lot of writing. You can start putting a novel down. Because this happens, and start rambling pretty quickly. We learned this math notation for a reason. That's a great example of that. All right, number 20, find each point of discontinuity, which are removable, not removable. Here we just have to graph this ourselves. So here I'm going to read this as a negative x plus 3. 1, 2, 3, and it's a negative x. So I'm going to plot some points for where that goes. This is a linear portion. So I'll do this. I'm just putting these dots here so you can see what colors I'm using as I graph. And that's x values less than 2. So I better put an open circle when x equals 2 along that line and then connect the rest of it. Like so. All right, next in green, f of x equals 2 when x equals 2. So 1, 2, that was easy. And then lastly, f of x equals x over 2 if x is greater than 2. So here we got a 1 half x, like so. We're not including the 2. So again, that's an open circle there. But then as soon as we get past it, we've got this nice little linear portion. All right, flag that one as the red location on the graph. Okay, so there's a discontinuity. At x equals 2, this is a removable discontinuity. Since the limit as x approaches 2 of f of x, it does exist. They're agreeing on a height of 1, the blue line and the red line, as we move in towards that value. But f of 2 actually equals 2. Ironically, kind of the same instance that we saw up above, but it's the same concept. Hopefully we're seeing that visualized a little bit. All right, next, probably the only real algebra that we have to do here is find a formula for the extended function that is continuous. So these are examples that have removable discontinuities, and we're going to remove the discontinuity to give a continuous function to work with. Okay, so the extended function is going to be piecewise, and that's how we're going to patch kind of like a hole in the graph where that issue happens. So for 26, what I've got here is x to the third minus 1 over x to the second minus 1. And this one is got some interesting factoring to it. You may or may not remember sum or difference of perfect cubes factoring, but what I've got here is x to the third minus 1 to the third, which factors out just x to the first minus 1 to the first, and then x squared plus 1 times x, and then second thing squared plus 1. And my denominator is a difference of perfect squares. It factors to x minus 1 times x plus 1. So it's that same type of algebra that we used when we were first learning about limits and how to handle them algebraically. We're canceling out the problem here. If I were to try and substitute in a 1, hopefully we can see that that would turn into a 0 over 0. And so we get this function. All right. And so f of x equals x squared plus x plus 1 all over x plus 1. Well, if I take f of 1, I get 1 plus 1 plus 1, 3 over x plus 1, 2 when I plug in a 1. So then I can rewrite f of x as the extended function using a piecewise x to the third minus 1. I'm just going to use the original because this worked perfectly as long as x does not equal 1. And then I just want to output the value of 3 halves when x equals 1. Now that we've got this patch, we can use our function and we've filled in that removable discontinuity. That's it. Now I say that's it, but there's kind of a lot of sneaky algebra that goes along behind that. We had to really pull into the factoring archives there a little bit. Number 28, sine of 4x over x when x equals 0. Well, we have this kind of sine of x over x thing, and maybe we're thinking in the back of our minds, hey, I remember that the limit as x approaches 0 of sine of just x over x, that equals 1. Let's see what we can do with that. So sine of 4x over x can then be rewritten. We're going to use some double angle identities. 2 times the sine of 2x times the cosine of 2x all over x. And notice, if I were to plug in an x equals 0, I have no problems going into cosine. But when I go into sine, I get a 0, and then the denominator also becomes 0. So that's my issue. I notice that I also have another sine of 2x in there. So I'm going to use the double angle identity again. So I've got 2 times, and then instead of that sine 2x, I'm going to put 2 sine x cosine x. And then I've still got that times cosine 2x. You can kind of see how all I changed was the sine of 2x. Everything else stayed the same over x. And I can just think of it this way. I've got a 2 times 2, which is 4, times I got a sine x over x, which I know as I get close to 0, that should be outputting a 1, times cosine of x times cosine of 2x. And if I were to plug in a 0 here, or approach a 0 here, so let's say this. Limit as x approaches 0 of f of x, this would be 4 times 1 times cosine at 0 is 1. Cosine at 2 times 0 is also 1. It equals 4. So now I'm going to rewrite that function. Here's the extended function. It's going to be just fine as it's sine of 4x over x as long as x does not equal 0. Sorry, I'm running out of room here. And then it's going to equal 4 when x equals 0. That patches up the hole in the graph and makes everything nice and clean and easy to work with. And for our final example today, here we've got a possible graph for a function. Man, I love these types of problems. You know that. It came up in a previous section. But we've got two conditions. First, f of negative 2 exists. There is a point on the graph. When I plug in a negative 2, I get some output. Now, they don't care where. So when x is negative 2, I'm just going to make a point negative 2, 5. You could choose any output you want there. I just chose 5. Now, as I approach that x value of negative 2 from the right, my function agrees with the height when I get there. But as I approach negative 2 overall with the function f, that limit does not exist. So as I come in from the right, I could have this graph, as long as it's a function, right? We still want to pass the vertical line test. It could be bending and twisting all over the place. You can make this look however you want, as long as it comes in smoothly when I get close to x equals negative 2. But now from the overall limit for that not working, I'm going to choose a jump discontinuity here. And so let's say I've got another bendy part of the graph here. And this would indicate that as I get close to negative 2, notice agreeing on a height here and here is not happening. So that's giving me the limit not existing. However, we do have the first part of letter B satisfied and part A satisfied as well. So that was actually probably quite a bit easier than the last one of those that we did. One thing to make sure of, though, is it's tempting to just go crazy and think you're an abstract artist and start doing that. Make sure that we don't see anything like this where our function fails the vertical line test. It does still have to be a function. And sometimes they will say something that the graph of f has a domain of all real numbers. That's how I sketched this here, that aside from that one little hiccup at x equals negative 2, the graph does continue to go to the left and go to the right. They didn't make that claim here, but sometimes they do. All right, that does it for section 1.3. Here's a look at your assignment. Thank you for watching.